and gentlemen, join me in welcoming the Honorable Mark Leno.
So you can also file this under your small accumulation of Golda Meir jokes. So my family was part of a Russian wave of immigration to Milwaukee, Wisconsin at the turn of the 20th century, as was Golda Meir's family. And she spent some years in school in Milwaukee before she went off to Palestine and of course Israel. And as the story goes, as she was traveling to Palestine and going through immigration and customs and asked a lot of questions, they asked her sex. She said, once in Milwaukee. So, Dr. Vivian Meek, let me say, you may not be the most humble person in this room, but you are by far the most inspirational. Let me thank you for living your life out loud. Leading the way in a very challenging world, and for being the very brilliant and accomplished professional that you are. You are a treasure. Thank you so much. And you can cyber stalk me anytime. That reference to Milwaukee, she done her homework. And yes, got here in 77, 3 years after the establishment of the GGBA, and I started my business in 1978. And I was thrilled by the very thought, the concept, the idea of an LGBT Chamber of Commerce, a group of business people who were there to support each other and to move what was certainly a massive wave of immigration, migration to the city at the time, our community. And I also have to admit that I had just missed the deadline for the Yellow Pages book, and I was desperate for a place that my business name could be listed that first year, and GGBA would have me. The rest is all history. With great vision and compassion and real thought, the leaders of the GGBA at the time, led by a fellow named Arthur Lazare, a dear friend no longer with us, realized that the Golden Gate Business Association had something significant to give back to our ever-growing community and its social needs. And so the Golden Gate Business Association Foundation was established. About 5 years later, the foundation realized that it needed to come into its own. Yes, it had been founded by the GGBA, but it was now time to establish its own identity. And my deceased partner, Doug Jackson, who had an expertise in public relations and marketing, was on their board of directors, and it was Doug and his board members who chose the name Horizons Foundation and a logo for it, and then began the process of rebranding it. And so, for obvious reasons, Doug died 5 years later. The GGBA Foundation, now the Horizons Foundation, always has held a very special place in my heart. And I'm told, I think this is accurate, that at the time of Doug's death, when he established, without any conversations with me, a donor-advised fund, the very first one at the Horizons Foundation. And so there was the Douglas McMaster Jackson Fund at the GGBA. So my connection with it is very heartfelt. The good news is that the foundation has continued to grow. They have been the seed money for a few organizations you might have heard of, the National Center for Lesbian Rights, the Gay Games, the San Francisco AIDS Foundation, Project Open Hand, just a few. Those are the big names you would know, but even probably equally, if not more important, the hundreds of smaller community-based organizations that serve every aspect of our broad community in ways you may never even know of. But the $5,000 or $10,000 or $20,000 grant that they'll get from the Horizon Foundation literally gets them off the ground and allows them to continue in their great social service. And so we have a lot to be proud of. Currently, executive director is a dear friend and a great leader, Roger Downey. And we're here today to recognize him and the Horizons Foundation. And just a brief word about Roger. This is a gay man who comes to the Horizons Foundation with a great personal history in fighting for social justice and for economic justice and for LGBT civil rights. A really perfect job description for what he needed to do at the Horizons Foundation. And has he done it well? I don't have all the numbers to share with you how it has exponentially grown. Not only are they raising money, putting money into a trust so that we can continue to fund our community in years ahead, but has done it in such a thoughtful way, strategic every step of the way. Dr. King once said that power without love is reckless and abusive, and that love without power is anemic and sentimental. But power at its best is love implementing the demands of justice. And Roger, that's what I see you doing every day of the year. You are love implementing the demands of justice. So please join me on stage so we can recognize you.
Organizations. And across that whole span of time, there are two things that have remained constant. Which a lot of things have remained constant, but a couple that I want to point out. Number one is that nonprofits are our focus and our greatest love. They are the backbone of our community. They advocate for us, they take care of our community's needs, they celebrate our lives through arts and in culture. And that includes, as Mark alluded to briefly, the smaller organizations. We're very proud to support the larger organizations that do so much work for us, but we also support smaller organizations in all different parts of the community. And that brings me to the second point that Horizons has always been based on, that is that we're here for the whole community. We're not here for just one population, just one group, one county or another county. We are here for the entire community. And when you look through the list of Horizons grants, literally 25 pages of grants that Horizons has made, what you see is, you see the history of the community itself. You read from the very beginning those grants that Mark alluded to of the National Center for Lesbian Rights, which was actually called the Lesbian Rights Project at the time. The first grants made in the HIV epidemic. You see the grants that happened when communities of color began to find their voices and began to form organizations in our community. You see grants when transgender organizations began to find their voices and form organizations. You see all of that in this grants list. And that grants list isn't just ossified in history, it's living today. So to just pull out a couple of examples from the last few months, we made grants to a youth organization in Napa and Sonoma counties serving hundreds of LGBTQ youths, often in remote parts of the county. We made another grant to a transgender rights organization that is doing advocacy for intersex and transgender people who are in the prison system. We made a grant to a group of gay and bisexual men in the South Bay, or Latino gay and bisexual men, and another grant went to a documentary film about the life of an Iraqi gay refugee who has come here to tell his story, and dozens and dozens and dozens more. And that's the story of Horizons, and that is the story of what GGBA Foundation, has gave birth to 37 years ago. There's one other thing that I wanted to share, and that is that we know that our grants are never gonna be enough. Even as our grants have gone up, as we've grown, they're never gonna be enough. Because the nonprofits that are meeting our community's needs, almost all of them struggle month to month to make payroll, to keep the lights on, to make sure services are delivered. And that is going to be ever more the case. I'm not gonna mention his name, but you all know who I'm talking about. When those budget cuts come down, when some of those policies go into effect, we're already seeing it in organizations, we're gonna be depending more and more and more on our nonprofit organizations. So the question for Horizons has been, how do we get more resources to those organizations so that they can do their good work in addition to the grants that we make? And we've done this in a variety of different ways. We've advocated with mainstream foundations to bring more money to the community. We work with hundreds of donors everywhere, led by my Vice President of Development, Deb Stallings, who works with many of those donors, and a variety of other ways. But what we realized also is that we need a more permanent solution. We need a way of thinking about our future that makes sure that we have resources down the road. And maybe 6 months ago or 12 months ago, some people in our community might have thought, you know, we're on kind of this glide path to perfect justice and equality. And things were looking pretty good. And there's still reasons to feel very good about a lot of the trends. But we got a terrible reminder just a few months ago, and what we're seeing every day now, that we can't know what's in the future. We simply cannot know. And so it's up to us to be able to plan for that future, and we actually have a way of doing it. There is one way of doing it to ensure that we have the resources that our community will need for generations to come, and that's through legacy giving. That is through what funds people have in their estates. It's not a new idea in the world, but it's a new idea in our world. And for us, it is an incredible opportunity, and it is an unprecedented and historic and once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And so we have announced two ambitious goals. One is that we will have at least $100 million in planned gift commitments by the year 2020, which will be the 40th anniversary of our founding. And the second is that we will have, over a greater period of time, we will develop an endowment for this community of a minimum of $100 million also. So we believe that we can go far faster. Now, our community. This is a student, but not the nonprofit world, not our community. And we believe that the time has come for us to do that and to put forward that vision And it is absolutely within our grasp to do that. And consider three quick things. Number one, 2/3 of a student have our children. Now, people with kids can be every bit as generous as people who don't have kids. Let me be clear. But not having kids opens up a lot of philanthropic opportunity in people's estates. Second, many of us, like myself and like many in the room just looking around, are part of generally the Stonewall generation, coming into a time of our lives when we were thinking about, well, what do we want our legacy to be? And for so many of us to have an opportunity to have a part of our legacy go to support the community that we've been a part of, that's given so much to us, and that we ourselves have often participated in helping to build. And lastly, the resources are there. Horizons has calculated, I'll be happy to show the methodology later if people want, but it's calculated that we have more than $40 billion in residential real estate wealth in our community alone. That's $40 billion with B. And if we can capture only 1% of that money, $400 million for our community, that could be transformative for our community organizations, it could be transformative for people's lives. And not just now, but for generations and generations to come. And that vision builds directly on what GGBA Foundation's vision was back at our origin in 1980. Because in the end, we need each other. We need us. And that's the belief that Horizons has been built on, that GGBA has been built on, our community's been built on, the movement's been built on, and that our future, the future that we will have together, that it must be built on too. And there is this clear through line from GGBA's founding of the foundation all the way through to the work that we are so privileged to do today. And I just can't tell you what an honor. What an honor it is to be here with you together in celebration and in service. In service to this community that we all care about so much, and I know that every person in this room loves so much. In this flawed and sometimes weird, but magical and wondrous place that we're all privileged to call home.